Hi, my name is Kate Jenks, and I'd love to welcome you to Christ Community Brookside's online worship experience. We're so glad you decided to join us. I do want to let you all know of a few great upcoming events in the next few weeks. This Thursday, we'll have our third worship night in the park, and this time it will be at Austin Harmon Park in Prairie Village, and the time that it starts is 6:30. So please just bring a chair and we'll provide the band and the lyrics. Next Sunday, October 25th, we have for families our drive-through Boo Bash, where kids can come dressed in costume, see staff dressed in costume, giving out candy, and we're also handing out Faith at Home packets for you to enjoy as a family in the month of November. So please go online and register so we know how many to have. Lastly, on November 1st at 5:30, we have our membership dinner and event. So if you're interested in becoming a member or even just want to come and explore it and you have questions, please sign up and we will have limited childcare available. Also, feel free to email Pastor Bill if you have any questions. All right, well, before we worship, I just want to remind you that you can go online to fill out our Connect card or our prayer card if we can connect with you more personally in any way. All right, well, we're going to continue today in our series in the book of Revelation. So before we do that, let's come together in worship.
I see. place where I can find you. Here in the valley of the shadows, give me eyes to see where you're leading me. I know a place where I can feel you. Here in the freedom of forgiveness, give me strength to hold fast to what I know.
Today's scripture reading is from Revelation 11, verses 15 to 18. And the seventh angel sounded, and there arose loud voices in heaven saying, "The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he will reign forever and ever. And the 24 elders who sit on their thrones before God fell on their faces and worshiped God, saying, We give thee thanks, O Lord God, the Almighty, who art and who was, because thou hast taken thy great power and hast begun to reign. This is the word of the Lord. Praise be to God."
Good morning, Christ Community, online church family, Brookside Campus. We're so glad that you have joined us today. And whether you're watching here in Kansas City or across the country or maybe even across the world, wherever you're joining us for this service this morning, today, we're so grateful that you're with us. We love you. We care about you, whether this is your first time ever joining us online or whether you've been a part of Christ Community for a really long time. We're so glad that you're here. We're in the book of Revelation studying this together. And as we prepare to look at this passage, let me just pray for us as we start. Father in heaven, thank you that you continue to unite us together as the body of Christ across time and space by the power of your Spirit. We ask that as we look at your word together today, that we would be encouraged, we'd be strengthened, we'd be challenged, that we'd be enriched. So give us insight afresh into your word today. Amen. Well, back in April, when the pandemic was kind of just really getting started and in full swing, the journalist Terry Gross interviewed horror fiction writer Stephen King. And I love the title of the article. It says, "Stephen King is sorry you feel like you're stuck in a Stephen King novel." And, you know, Stephen King's a great storyteller, I think one of the best of our time. And he's actually written a lot of books that aren't in the horror kind of genre, The Shawshank Redemption, The Green Mile, 11/22/63, which is a novel about the Kennedy assassination. But prior to this year, I had never read a single page of Stephen King. And I'd always assumed his books were all just kind of in this gory horror story kind of thing, and that was just, that's not my thing, that's not the kind of stories I like. But this spring, at the urging of a friend, I decided to try The Shining, which is supposed to be one of King's best books. And so I gave it a shot. And while it is definitely creepy, and it is certainly not for everyone by any stretch of the imagination, I found myself enjoying it immensely. And it was actually a very different kind of scary than what I was expecting. And then later on vacation in August, I read the sequel that King wrote to The Shining called Dr. Sleep, which he wrote a number of years afterward. And what I'm discovering as I've read some Stephen King is this, that in his stories, one, evil is always real. Evil is always real. Two, evil is never merely human. So it's never merely human. It's always supernatural as well. And then finally, that in his stories, evil is always defeated by goodness through sacrifice. And in particular, as I was reading Dr. Sleep and getting to sort of the climactic conflict point of that story, I found myself actually hating evil more than I was afraid of it. I found myself hating evil and wanting to see it defeated even more than I was afraid of it. I think it's a great power that King has in his writing. And one of the things that Revelation, the book we're looking at, this final book of the scriptures, is revealing, is uncovering, is making known, is that we are living in a story. We are living in a story, and it is a story with heroes and villains and not merely human actors. And, you know, in our world, there are lots of competing narratives and competing stories that would beckon us, that promise meaning and hope and fulfillment, that promise to make sad things come untrue. Stories of power and safety, sexual fulfillment, comfort, financial security, all that promise to give us what we long for, promise to ease the ache, promise to defeat the enemies of loneliness and pain and emptiness and insecurity that haunt every single one of us. As Christians, as the local church across time and space, geography and language and culture and tribe, we also have a story to tell, a better one, a true one. And it's time to tell it. And our story is not that we're right, we're better, and that everyone else is wrong and dumb and stupid. No, our story is that we have found rescue in the slain lamb, and we're inviting others to come and be rescued by him too. That's the story we're telling. There is a lamb who was slain to rescue, who's going to make all things right. Would you come and experience the joy and satisfaction and rescue and hope that we found in him? But Jesus has promised in the Gospels, and Revelation confirms, that story will not always be met with eager acceptance. And in fact, that the church will regularly be hated for that story. Because for as many people who will be drawn to the story, who will come to it for rescue and salvation, there are supernatural forces and those under their sway who are allied against the story and will do anything to stop it. And as we look at this section of Revelation today, we are going to see that the suffering for bearing witness to the story of the Lamb is inevitable, but not final. That's the bottom line. Suffering is inevitable. It is the inevitable, but not the final experiences of witnesses, of Christians, of the church. It's the inevitable, but not the final experience. Now, we are going to cover a pretty large portion of the book of Revelation today. We're going to focus on chapter 11, but the themes that culminate in chapter 11 begin all the way back in chapter 8. And we need some help here as we look at this part of the book, because the apocalyptic images really get turned up to 11, to borrow the Spinal Tap reference. They really get cranked up to their loudest volume, their brightest colors, their most vivid expression in these chapters. So before diving into the heart of this text this morning, I just want to offer us some helps on reading this section of Revelation and this, really this whole middle part of the book. So there are three things at least to keep in mind here. First is that Revelation is apocalyptic literature, which by design speaks of real realities. This is really important. This is not make-believe. This is not imagined. This is not just merely metaphor. It speaks of real realities, but in intentionally highly symbolic images. Real realities with intentionally highly symbolic language and images. So Revelation in that way is a lot more like Van Gogh's Starry Night than a picture or an image from the Hubble Space Telescope. And just like poetry communicates differently than a news report or a novel, so this Revelation communicates differently than the narratives in the gospel. And poetry, again, it takes more work. It uses images and metaphors and similes that create a feeling and engage our imagination and our right brain. And sometimes I think we can get frustrated, whether it's with poetry, whether it's with apocalyptic literature, because why not just say it plainly? Just say it. Give me the facts. Don't wrap it in all these images and these symbols and these numbers and all this. Just tell me. But Revelation, apocalyptic literature, is not designed just to inform us, but to form us. It's not just about informing us, but forming us and our imaginations and our vision, our way of seeing the world in a particular way. And it does that by going at our right brain through these images, these symbols, and this imaginative work. And just as something that is, and this is important to remember, just because something uses images and symbols doesn't mean it can't speak of true things, past, present, and future, as Revelation does. And by the same token, just because something is written in a more straightforward kind of prose reporting style doesn't mean that it can't lie or tell falsehood, right? There's a lot of fake news out there. So whether it is we're reading our sort of apocalyptic Revelation genre of literature on Sunday morning or our news reports on Monday morning, we have to be discerning. We have to apply the right rules, the right literary conventions to understanding the type of literature we're reading. So that's the first thing. Second thing is that because we are dealing with highly symbolic literature, we need to be cautious about reading the symbols. For example, one of the symbols you get in this section is locusts who are like horses with human faces and teeth like lions and tails like scorpions. We need to be careful about reading those symbols as physical descriptions and rather understand them that they're showing the characteristics of the indescribable. They're characteristic descriptions of the indescribable. They are talking about the power, the swiftness, the intelligence, the fierceness, the capability of inflicting intense pain and torment. But they are characteristic descriptions of the indescribable. They are depicting and revealing real realities, but by doing so with symbolic descriptions. Again, like Van Gogh's Starry Night is a painting of something very real. Van Gogh is painting the night sky in southern France. It is a very real, true, concrete reality that he is depicting, the night sky over southern France. But he's using the medium of post-impressionism to communicate more than photorealism ever could. His goal is not just to communicate the facts, but meaning. Not just inform us about the sky in France, but capture our imaginations with the beauty and the meaning and the significance of it. And then third, Revelation is not just about what's going to happen in the future, but about what is happening in the present. Let me say that again. Don't miss that. Revelation is not just about what will happen in the future. It is about what is happening in the present also. And our goal in this series is not to parse every detail or map on every verse of Revelation to some kind of current news event happening today, as enticing as that temptation is in the midst of the events of 2020. Rather, our goal is to understand these words and how these words are meant to encourage us today. Just as they were meant to encourage readers in the first century, as they encourage Christians in the second century, in the eighth century, in the 12th century, and for us in the 21st century. So yes, the book of Revelation is about the future, it is about what is coming, but it is also about today and has deep meaning and significance for us here and now. And New Testament expert Michael Gorman writes this. He says, without ignoring the past or the future, in a general sense, the focus is on revelation as a word to the church in the present. That's right on. If you want to dive deeper into understanding this kind of literature, because there's way more that we could talk about than we have time in the sermon, I encourage you to do two things. One, we are hosting, the campus pastors across Christ Community are hosting something on Monday evenings, Facebook Live. It's going to be a live event for the next coming series of Monday evenings called Nothing Else Is On. It's going to be a conversation about how to read Revelation. And it's, again, it's going to be live. You can join us at 8 p.m. on Facebook. You can ask questions. We're going to dive in deeper than what we're able to do on Sunday mornings in sermons and unpack more of these. And so if you have questions about this book, if you're reading it and you're like, I don't understand what's going on here, I don't know that we'll be able to give you any better explanations, but we're going to try to have some deeper conversation on those conversations on Monday nights. So you can join us for that. The second thing, if you want to do a little more work on your own here, is you can just put into Google the Bible Project Revelation, the Bible Project Revelation, and that should pull up a number of videos on YouTube or the Bible Project website that talk about how to read apocalyptic literature. It gives you an overview of the book of Revelation. They're just immensely helpful. Now, the section that we're looking at today in Revelation is one of the more difficult sections in the book. Actually, one commentator said this is perhaps the most difficult passage to interpret in the entire book of Revelation. So here, Revelation chapter 11, we are going to work on understanding one of the most difficult to interpret passages in one of the most difficult books in the Bible. I can't even say it. It's so difficult. But that's what we're going to look at today. But one thing is clear in these texts, and that is that we as the church have a story to tell. And here are three truths that unfold in this section. And the first one is this, that the church will tell the story. The church will tell this better story. It will bear witnesses. We are witnesses to this story. And this section of Revelation that we're looking at begins back in Revelation chapter 8, verse 6, and it continues through here the end of chapter 11. And it's organized around these seven trumpet judgments. And most of chapters 8, 9, and 10 are just vivid, turned up to 11, max volume, max color pictures of judgment. And they draw actually heavily, the imagery, the symbols draw heavily on the book of Exodus when God sends the 10 plagues on Egypt in an effort to entice and persuade Pharaoh to let God's people go. So God's people have been held captive in Egypt and 400 years in enslavement, and he sends these 10 plagues. John, in these apocalyptic visions that he has, draws on that imagery from Revelation to, and then kind of turns those plagues up to full volume to communicate what God is doing here. More on that later, but where am I getting this language of witnesses? Well, witness is a consistent way that Christians, believers, the church is described in the book of Revelation, but in particular here in Revelation chapter 11, you see it in verses 3 and 4, and it reads like this, "And I will grant authority to my two witnesses, and they will prophesy for 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. These are the two olive trees and the two lampstands that stand before the Lord of the earth." Now again, this is one of the most difficult passages to interpret in the Bible. So there's not everyone agrees on how to interpret these symbols, but most scholars do agree that the two witnesses represent, in part at least, the local church throughout the history of the church, bearing witness to Jesus. It doesn't mean that there couldn't also be a fulfillment of two literal witnesses some point in the future, but most scholars say that at least a part of what John is doing with this image of the two witnesses is talking about the work of the church bearing witness to Jesus throughout all time and space. And what? Why do interpreters say that? Well, because this language of lampstand in particular, it echoes back to chapters 2 and 3, where John referred to the seven churches that were addressed in these seven letters from Jesus. They were referred to as lampstands. And so this lampstand imagery is connected with the churches. Now, what is it that the church bears witness to? Again, being faithful witnesses to Jesus is, who is the ultimate faithfulness, is one of the key themes of the book. But what is it that we're bearing witness to? What is the story that we're telling? Well, we testify to the coming, the already breaking in, though not fully yet here, kingdom of God. And we tell the story that sin is real and that we cannot save ourselves and that we have a supernatural enemy who is behind the ultimate evils in the world. This is one of the things that I've been so affected by in reading Stephen King's novels, is he helps you feel the darkness and the despair and the helplessness of supernatural evil in the world. And one of the problems that we face in our cultural moment today for all of us is that our imaginations are so shaped by what philosopher Charles Taylor calls the immanent frame, that which simply means that we think primarily about the material world. We do not think about the supernatural world that is as real as this pulpit, this podium, is as real as the TV, the phone, the device you're watching this on, but we don't think about it. And as a result, our diagnoses and solutions to the problems in the world fall short. So for example, we may say that the real problem in the world is we just need better education. We need a better education. People need to be educated, have better access to education. And that is true, right? We do need better education systems, more equitable education systems. That's absolutely true. But is it the heart of the problem? Is it the root of the problem? Others might say, well, what's really at the part of this is we need better, higher paying jobs. We need to free up regulation to make the economy the best that it can be so that job creators and entrepreneurs can start businesses and hire people. And that's the real heart of this. If we can just get people good, high paying jobs, then we'll solve so many of our problems. And it's true. We do need good, high paying jobs. Absolutely, we do. Or maybe you might say, well, no, really what the problem is people just don't have access to affordable and safe and equitable healthcare options. We just don't have, like, healthcare is there's so many disparities in who gets what and how do we pay for it and how do we do that well? And of course, we need to solve issues of healthcare access and how are we going to pay for it and how does that work? Of course. We look at the justice system. We need a more just justice system. And we do need that as well. Of course we do. But here is the problem. Look at the people in the world who are highly educated, who have not had problems with the criminal justice system, who have high-paying jobs and access to health care. And they're still high rates of anxiety, depression, divorce, mental health crises, loneliness, isolation. And for every one of us, we face death at the end of life, no matter who we are. Our problem is so much deeper than any of those things can fix. Our story is that there is a real enemy and that each one of us was actually born on his side, aligned against the one true king of the universe, but that the king came to rescue us and snatch us away from that enemy and give us new life, and that the kingdom of God is coming. And when it comes in full, it will mean life and justice and flourishing and healing, which is why education and jobs and healthcare matter now, because they are foretastes and invite others to imagine what can be right now because Jesus is on the throne and what one day will be fully when he comes in power to reign and rule and set all things right, when evil is finally defeated. And so we need to speak up to tell the truth. And here's one easy way. This is a simple way to tell the truth. Just invite others to watch our church services. I mean, it's never been easier in this moment to invite someone to church. I mean, you're watching right now online, and it could be as simple as just, who's a friend, a family member who you think, I don't know if they'd come to church, but maybe they'd watch one of these things. Will you just send them a direct message or post on Facebook or email or text and just say something like, you know, hey friend, I was thinking about you today and hope you're doing well. And my church, my faith community has just been such a help to me in this time, helping me make sense, process all that's going on. And I think you might enjoy checking out some of our services sometime. Here's a link to our YouTube channel. Here's a link to where you can watch the services online on our website. It's so easy to do that right now. Another way we bear witness to this is in our work, in the goodness of God. We tell of the goodness of his world, and we witness to the goodness of what he's doing. We become the hands and feet of Jesus, the body of Christ, loving and serving our neighbors in our work. So do your work well. It matters more than you will ever know. And it is harder now than ever. And I get that for so many of us. Our jobs have gotten more complicated, more complex in this time. Some of us are without a job. We're looking for a job. But I just want you to know that Jesus is forming your character. He's creating virtue in you in this time, in this season, and you are not there by accident. He has positioned you in your place of work, whether that is at home, at an office, in a hospital, educating kids at home, doing Zoom learning at home, whatever it is that you do with the majority of your time, it is not by accident. Jesus has placed you in that place, in that role for this time in 2020 because he has a purpose for you there. And he's doing something to form and shape you in that place. Bear witness to the hope that you have in the work that you do every day. But even though we speak the story boldly and winsomely, a story of unfailing hope and rescue, not all will be persuaded. Which brings us to the second truth about the story, and that is that the nations will hate us. And this is the reality that John has turned up to 11 in these chapters. Take a look at chapter 11, verse 17, where he writes this, "We give thanks, Lord God Almighty, who is and who was, because you have taken your great power and have begun to reign. The nations were angry, but your wrath has come." The nations were angry, but your wrath has come. There is, friends, a world order, systems, and individual human hearts that are aligned against the kingdom of God. As Brian Ficker, the economist, explains, that broken people build broken systems that break people who in turn build and perpetuate broken systems that continue to break people, and the cycle continues. And when broken people and broken systems encounter the offer of wholeness and healing, the response is not always one of excitement and joy and welcome, but it's most often, many times, rebellion and resistance and opposition. But this shouldn't surprise us, right? Because telling the truth can sometimes get you in trouble, right? Friend asks you what you think of their new haircut. Your brother asks you what you think of his new GarageBand's latest recording. Your boss pulls you aside and says, what do you really think of my leadership style? What do you really think about our company? And, I've seen enough mafia movies along my life to know that being a witness can be a pretty deadly endeavor, right? There's a reason that witness protection programs exist, right? Being a witness can be a very dangerous thing. And writing about this section of Revelation, Eugene Peterson writes that it is a difficult and dangerous thing to tell the truth. It is difficult and dangerous to tell the truth. So what does that mean for us? Well, it means that we should expect suffering. There's no way around it. This is the inevitable experience for us. Suffering is the inevitable, but not the final experience of witnesses. It's the inevitable, but not the final experience of witnesses. If you give Jesus and his kingdom your highest loyalty and allegiance, you will find yourself suffering. Maybe you will be left out of key networking conversations and meetings because you won't participate in certain kinds of activities or go to certain venues or restaurants. Maybe you'll find yourself single for far longer than you imagined because you're not willing to use certain kinds of dating platforms or dating apps or participate in certain kind of expectations of hookup culture. Maybe you find yourself ridiculed because you take, as we ought to, deeply ought to take and stand for, a biblically based pro-life position from conception all the way to the final breath that we draw. You find yourself misunderstood, judged, opposed because you hold that position. If you are never uncomfortable because of your allegiance to Jesus, you need to go back to the letters of the seven churches in Revelation chapter 2 and 3 and ask yourself, where am I compromising, maybe without even knowing it? Because suffering is the inevitable experience of faithful witnesses. And Jesus was the ultimate faithful witness, and he suffered the most. But because he suffered before us and for us, we know that suffering will not have the last word. Because Jesus has suffered both before us and on our behalf, we know that suffering will not have the last word, which brings us to our third and final truth this morning, and that is that the Lamb will end it. The Lamb will end it. If you keep reading, you get to this in verse 18, you get these words, "The nations were enraged, but your wrath has come, and the time has come for the dead to be judged, And the time has come to give your servants, the prophets, their reward, as well as to the saints and to those who revere your name, both small and great. And the time has come to destroy those who destroy the earth. The time has come to destroy those who destroy the earth. Now, that language of those who destroy the earth, that's not just merely talking about those who have somehow been involved in, you know, environmental pollution at some point along their lives. Though, for example, a number of Native American Christian theologians have added incredible insight to the church around the significance of land and place that we cannot overlook, and the significance of God creating place and land and people who belong in particular places. But here, the language of earth stands in contrast to the language of heaven. So, for example, at the very beginning of your Bible, God created the heavens and the earth. Heaven is God's space, earth is human space. The whole project of the Bible from Genesis all the way to Revelation is the idea that those two spaces come together and are linked and are one. So when it says the destroyers of the earth, those who have mocked and destroyed and oppressed the image bearers in human space, and the slain land who sits upon the throne has promised that he will stop those who are destroying and wreaking havoc on his good world and oppressing his image bearers. But this isn't a spiteful, proud, arrogant judgment. This is not a judgment on those who are pleading and longing to be rescued. And God is like, nah, I don't think so. I'm going to spite you and judge you instead. No, this is God's settled opposition to anyone or anything that would stand against his purpose to rescue and renew the world. Even the judgments themselves are designed to wake people up, to bring us to a place of seeing our complicity in evil and running to the Lamb to rescue. Just like the plagues in Egypt were designed in part to bring Pharaoh to repentance. But if, like Pharaoh, some persist in hardness of heart, God will let evil ultimately collapse in on itself and destroy itself. The destroyers will be destroyed. Listen to how Michael Gorman puts this. He says, finally, in the book of Revelation, divine judgment is not an end in of itself. It is God's plan B when humanity persists in evil rather than repenting. It then becomes a means, a necessary means, but to be sure, but still only a means to the fulfillment of God's plan to heal the nations and create a space for all people to flourish in harmony with one another before God. Yes, the sequences of judgments in the seals and the trumpets and the bowls in this section of Revelation are vivid and disturbing. They are designed to be disturbing. We ought to be disturbed by them, but they are meant to give us hope. They're meant to give hope to the suffering people of God, that evil and sadness and oppression and wrongdoing will not always get the last word, that the supernatural forces of evil and those aligned with them will not always win. And remember, Revelation is not primarily addressed to Babylon or to Rome or to the world. It is addressed to the church. It is written to us to give us hope as we endure in our witness to the Lamb who is slain. So friends, wait patiently. Wait patiently. I love how Tim Keller puts it. God will allow evil only to the degree that it brings about the very opposite of what it intends. That's absolutely right. God will allow evil only to the degree that it brings about the very opposite of what it intends. We live in a world where the wrongs seem off so strong, but God, friends, God is the ruler yet. The Lamb was slain to rescue and rule, and those who stand in resistance to that rule will not succeed. The destroyers will be destroyed, and so we wait patiently, bearing witness to the Lamb who is slain, whose kingdom is coming as surely as suffering is real, and the Lamb will end it. The kingdom of the world will become the kingdom of our Lord and his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. He defeated evil, and he set us free from its grip and enslavement through his death and resurrection. Because when Jesus defeats evil, he doesn't do it on evil's terms. He doesn't return evil for evil, but overcomes evil with good through sacrifice, beating evil at its own game, bringing about the very opposite of what it intends. And in communion, in the practice of the Lord's Supper, we are nourished and strengthened for the work of witness and waiting. And as we remember and celebrate the paradoxical defeat of death by death, we are prepared and strengthened for the work of witness and waiting. So let's do that now together. If you have communion elements or anything that you can make into communion elements where you are, I'd encourage you to take a moment, especially if you have the opportunity with other followers of Jesus, wherever you're watching this, to pause, to celebrate communion together, to remember Jesus' sacrifice. So do that now. Thank you again, Christ Community, Brookside Campus family, for being with us in this online service today. We're so grateful for you. We miss you. We love you. We are praying for you. And as you go to the work that Jesus has called you to do, as you bear witness to him in it, I want to send you with these words of benediction. The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. And we join in the hosts of heaven, saying, we give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, who is and who was, for you have taken your great power and begun to reign. So go in peace to love and to serve and to bear witness to Jesus.